We're going to have a pretty fascinating conversation about a topic that I have to admit is not in the front lobe of most people's everyday thinking, but it is a topic that is very, very urgent given the issues of explosive urban growth and spiraling demands of consumers and citizens within what I think we would all agree is a particularly delicate natural setting. So we're going to explore how should you govern this region. Right now, Metro Vancouver really relies on a local government consensus decision-making model by nominated councillors to direct its planning and its activities. So given the urgent issues that we all know are out there, climate change, land rights, housing, transportation, transit, all requiring very, very decisive regional action, the question is the current structure adequate? Or would an empowered regional government directly elected by all of us be more effective and more accountable? So I think you can see the resolution here is elect regional representatives. So I want to offer a little bit of a background for those who may not really understand some of the details of how we do manage our regional affairs now. And it's important to know that when you start to listen to our debaters tonight. We have had some form of regional governance in our region here since way back in the 1920s. That had mostly to do with managing water. And then on into the 50s, that had mostly to do with managing sewer. But the first, really, what I would say legitimate comprehensive regional government started in 1967 with what became known as the GVRD, the Greater Vancouver Regional District, which morphed into what we know it today, Metro Vancouver, in 2017. We provide a tiered governance arrangement where there is a very clear division of labor between 23 local government bodies. That's only 21 municipalities. There's also a Treaty First Nation. And then everything left over, including UBC, is called an electoral district or area, which handles a very wide range of carefully articulated local affairs. And then a regional federation, which only handles matters that are felt to stretch across beyond a municipality and cover the whole region. Obviously, that's water, liquid and solid waste, to some degree housing, regional planning and environmental management, including regional parks, some degree of regional economic development, and then very importantly, cross-government, cross-local government collaboration. And by the way, we have 17 First Nations reserves in our region, nations without treaties or with only modest treaties that are only cover certain areas, and they are excluded from this federation. And we actually then separate out regional transportation, including transit, into a completely separate body, which we all know, of course, as TransLink. And I'll let the debaters argue about how well this arrangement is working on a day-to-day basis. And then this regional body, Metro Van, is composed of local government representatives with weighted voting based on population, and they're appointed by the various local governments. No one is specifically elected regional decisions. And again, our debaters will be arguing the case of is this a good or a bad thing. And of course, this model stands in contrast to some of the other things that you'll see elsewhere in the world, in North America. In some places, there is an elected regional government, or it's often called a county government. We may have in the United States often heard of those county governments. In some cases, there's been a fully amalgamated situation where there's just one government. You see this in New Zealand, for example, in their cities, and some places here in Canada as well. And in some cases, there is no regional government whatsoever, although there usually is some way to handle utilities, because if you can't handle utilities, think about it, you're kind of in trouble. So these systems, each one of them has its various pros and cons. The point is that there is, unfortunately, no one standard that you can just refer to and say, well, let's go this way. And that's why the debate tonight is so important, to really try to address the questions and try to confirm for us in this time, in this place, what is the best form that we should arrange ourselves to do regional governance. So we're going to do this Oxford-style debate. It's fast-moving. It's exciting. It requires a resolution, which is why you see that stated there, that can be argued very strongly for and very strongly against, and then you get to decide. You decide who wins. It's really that simple. But it's not just who gets the most votes. That's actually not how you win. The way you win is if you change the most minds. So if the debaters can change your mind, more of them can change your mind one way than the other, that's the team that will win tonight. So keep that in mind, and we'll be voting first so we get a first take, and then we'll vote after so that you can see what that is. So again, it is elect regional representatives. So with that background, I would like to just give a bit of a frame to the debate tonight so that we can get really to the point. Our question tonight is clearly about the method through which our regional government is brought to play or operationalized. It is not about having a regional government or not. That's a much more complex question. And I think in this world we live in, we know that some form of regional government definitely makes sense in principle. It is also not about dropping local governments altogether. That's a much more complex issue that has been played out in some parts of our country, and it's been a big drama going well beyond the issues we'll talk about tonight. On the other hand, the debate is certainly about who does what, when, and how. Who has the responsibility for doing the various things that need to be done? Because I think we can all understand as you get to that issue, you begin to have clarity about then how do you bring those people into decision-making positions. So I hope the debaters will focus very sharply on the essential choice of bringing our regional government together through either this federation of local government delegates, as we do it now, or through a free and separate election, as we might do it in the future. The bottom line is the status quo serving our changing needs, or do we need a new model? So here's how the evening is going to go. In a few minutes, you will vote before you hear any of the debaters, and we'll tabulate that and we'll declare it so you can all see it. Then the debaters will try their best to change your minds and to get less of you to agree with the other side and more of you to agree with them. And to do that, each member of this two-person debate team on each the pro and con side will be given a 7-minute period opening to make opening remarks, and then we will have a general exchange for about 20 minutes where they can talk to one another, but very importantly, where you can pose questions as well. And when we do that, I want you to say, this is going to Greg, or this is going to Michael. Pose your question to an individual. And I have a few questions also, just in case, we have a little bit of a dry spell, I don't think we will. And then each debater will have 2 minutes to make closing comments. Often those comments will be a rebut, a reference back to something they've heard in the debate. And then when we're done with that, we will ask you to vote again. And again, the team who wins is the team that changes most of your minds. So let's get going. I want to invite each of you to cast your vote now. Log into the URL that you see here, sala.ubc.ca/vote1, and vote on whether or not you think we should have the existing system or a system of directly elected representatives. And we're just going to pause and let you make that vote. And I think, if I'm right, you can also do that by hand. So if you don't want to do it on your phone or can't, then raise your hand and someone will bring a ballot to you. If anyone need a ballot, let us know. I'm pretty excited. Ooh. And the winner is pro, 77%. Cons, 23%. So that's our base, that's our starting point. 77% believe that we should have an elected form of representation. 23% believe we should stay pretty much as it is. So we'll be polling again and we'll be able to see just how much that changes. I want to now introduce to you the real excitement of the night, the teams, the pros and con teams. These are smart people. They are knowledgeable people. They are people that have been in this world of regional governance for a long time. And I like to say they're kind of brave people also. So please welcome tonight's city debaters. Arguing the pro position tonight, we have first Christina DeMarco, who was the lead planner for the current regional growth strategy, Metro Vancouver 2040. She has worked on regional plans under a variety of regional governance arrangements in Sydney, Canberra, Perth, in Australia, in Helsinki, in Finland. She teaches regional planning in the SFU City program. And her teammate is Michael Heaney. Michael is the past president and CEO of the Surrey City Development Corporation and is currently contributing to various organizations and projects through a company advisory company called C+O Advisory. Prior to this, he was the managing principal, and we all know him in this role in big time, of Bingtom Architects for over 28 years, where he oversaw the company's growth into a leading international practice. So let's invite this team to the podium, to the table. Come on out. This is their music. It's ABBA. Okay, and now on the con side. First, we have Carol Mason, following an accomplished career working for regional districts, previously as Metro Vancouver's Commissioner, Chief Administrative Officer, and before that as Regional District of Nanaimo CAO. Carol now works as a local government consultant, sharing her expertise in regional governance, strategic planning, Indigenous relations, financial management, regional growth, and board staff relations. And her teammate is Greg Moore. Greg is president and CEO of Icona Properties, and along with his wife, is also the owner of Patina Brewing Company. I think I got that right, didn't I? Yeah, I did. Greg was previously the mayor, we all know him in this role, the mayor of the city of Port Coquitlam, and he was the chair of the Metro Vancouver Board of Directors prior to politics. He was a city planner. So could I ask that team to come? That's really good, isn't it? I go like that and it just goes off. It's amazing. So each of the teams, as I've said, is going to be given 7 minutes to make their opening statements. I've said to you privately, and I'll say here in front of everyone, we have to be very sharp on that timing. And so I will be having to stop you right at 7 minutes, because it would be unfair if one team got 12 minutes, another team only got 7 minutes. So I'll apologize ahead of time, but I'm going to be kind of aggressive on that. And we're going to begin with Christina. Christina, why don't you come and argue for the resolution?
Okay, thank you, Larry, and good evening, everyone. Here's a region 2.6 million people spread over 23 jurisdictions, quirky historic boundaries ranging from Little Belcarra with just over 600 residents to the city of Vancouver with over 1,000 times that population. We don't really think much about regional services as long as water comes out of the tap and there's room in the landfill. I'm going to concentrate on those activities that take a much higher level of regional cooperation, the urgent issues of our times. How effective is the region in delivering solutions to these problems? Before I answer that question, I want to point out that there are a lot of unresolved tensions in the current system which undermine effectiveness. The fiscal system is the source of much tension with too much reliance on the property tax. Municipalities have to agree to share their tax base with the regional district and TransLink. Regional cooperation depends on how the local autonomy card is played. Regional planning, though, by definition, means giving up local autonomy to achieve regional goals. Whoops. Here are the Metro Vancouver 2050 goals from the latest regional plan, a solid set of goals that we can all aspire to. Effectiveness comes down to the basic question, does it work? The effectiveness of a metropolitan planning agency largely depends on how it can influence local land use to achieve regional goals. Let's take a look at some of the regional tools needed to meet the goals. The urban containment boundary, an essential metropolitan planning tool. Agree on a boundary and stick to it. A critical tool for a whole bunch of reasons, but especially from a climate perspective. Unfortunately, we are going in the wrong direction. The amendment process has been made weaker. A regional public hearing is no longer needed to expand the urban containment boundary. Several expansion areas have been approved or are under discussion. These will take us away from our climate targets. The pressure to use rural and agricultural land is only going to increase. On the economy, let's look at industrial land. Municipalities routinely rezoning industrial land without any regard to the regional supply. Offices were locating in former industrial parks and creating job sprawl. The regional industrial land zone in the plan serves the dual purpose of industrial land protection in steering office jobs to centers where they can be served by transit. Last year, regional planners updated their industrial land analysis and recommended that the board toughen the regional rezoning process. Sadly, the board voted against stricter rules, including both Surrey and Vancouver. On to housing. So three tools here, fiscal, regulatory, advocacy. When federal housing money disappeared, the region stopped building public housing. I remember staff asking for just $1 per household tax levy for seed money for public housing. The board said no. The board's position has improved since then, and Metro Housing is on track to produce about 130 new units a year for the next 10 years. But we have a long way to go. Metro has 3,400 public housing units right now, while the city of Toronto, which is roughly the same population of Metro Vancouver, has 60,000 public housing units. The region could also be leading with regulatory initiatives to increase housing supply. If the region doesn't, I'm sure the province is willing to help out with supply-side regulatory measures. Land use transportation coordination. We need to get the land use right to provide a cost-effective transit system. The metropolitan land use structure calls for a sub-regional jobs housing balance focused primarily on regional city centers served by SkyTrain and a network of buses so people can live close to their work. But look what is happening with office space distribution, too much in the metro core and too much outside the centers and not nearly enough inside those centers that give us the sub-regional jobs housing balance. The city of Vancouver is piling up job capacity in the Broadway corridor with no discussion on consequences for the rest of the region. They are proposing an additional 42,000 jobs in the corridor, while the regional plan target is for 57,000 in the entire metro core for 2041. Getting jobs in the right place is difficult and important work. One of my first assignments for the Sydney Metropolitan Plan was to determine which state government departments should move to the equivalent of our Surrey Metro Centre. The private sector followed the government lead. We are going in the wrong direction, leading to an inefficient use of the transit system and an impact on commuters' quality of life. If you live in Cloverdale, for example, and you work in the Broadway corridor, that transit trip will take you at least 1.5 hours now, and perhaps 5 to 7 minutes less when the new SkyTrain line opens. Cloverdale to Surrey Metro Centre, on the other hand, by bus takes less than half that time. Now on to climate. As we fail to meet climate change targets, the targets get quietly readjusted. The modeling from the Fraser Basin Council paints a bleak picture of flood risk for the year 2100. Two-thirds of the First Nation reserves in the Lower Mainland are located in the floodplain. The regional scale, is the right scale for coordinating climate adaptation measures. Civic leaders figured this out following the devastating 1948 flood. The Lower Mainland Regional Planning Board was created in 1949 in response, but later dismantled. As we found out last year, effective legislative and financial tools are still not in place, so each municipality fends for themselves. Time is running out. For me too. we are falling short. And in conclusion, the current system leads municipalities to continue to put local interests above regional interests, favors short-term over long-term, inadequately funded. Many of the solutions to our urgent issues lie at the regional scale, with governance reform essential.
Thank you, Christine. A very, very powerful argument, some beautiful imagery there. Thank you so much. Carol Mason, now come forward to argue against the resolution. Over to you.
Thank you, Larry. And thank you, everyone. It's really nice to see you all tonight and virtually. It's great to have the opportunity to talk about regional districts. Regional districts are a passion of mine. I've worked in regional districts for most of my career, and I can tell you that they're the most misunderstood form of government. The opening comments tonight and the con side, really, they tell you that it really is a misunderstood type of government. And so I'm quite comfortable being in the position that I'm on the con side explaining and defending regional districts, because I am used to doing that and speaking passionately about it and speaking to even municipalities about the benefits of the region. But tonight, Greg and I are here to explain to you why Metro Vancouver's governance model is not just effective and accountable, in our opinion. And we did work directly within the structure for a long time, so we do have a bit of a bias there, but we can tell you that it has a proven track record for success. It's been studied in depth, and it's been shown to be an effective governance model by the experts across the country. So the theme for tonight is, if it's not broken, don't fix it. Our pro side of the debate are supporting governance change, and a model being proposed is regionally elected government, but that has a track record as well, and not necessarily a good one. So let's let the debate begin. Now, some of these slides will be repetitive, so let me just see if I can get through. So this is Regional District 101. Regional districts, why do they exist? There's 27 regional districts across the province. As was mentioned earlier, the legislation was enacted in 1965, and it was established to create a greater need, to respond to the greater need for regional cooperation. The key is that it's working as a federation. So don't think government, think federation. It really is about all of the entities working together to create a better environment for our public and our taxpayers to live. So how are we governed? Each electoral area, the regional district is not unique to Metro Vancouver, it's across the province. So when we're talking about this, are we talking about just Metro Vancouver? Are we talking about everywhere across the province? It's got electoral area directors elected at large, but the regional directors are appointed by their councils or by Treaty First Nations. And they provide a broad range of powers, and they're taken for granted. So when we hear the comments that, well, of course you can look after the utilities, but where the real issues and conflict are in regional planning, the majority of the budget of regional districts is in those core utilities. It's in the water and the sewer and the solid waste services. And those are costs that are very high to the region. I think we have the same slide, Christine. So 23 member jurisdictions, about 2.6, 2.7 million residents, 53% of the population live within Metro Vancouver, 61% of BC's gross domestic product, and $7 billion in infrastructure over the next 5 years. So it is a machine managing the Metro Vancouver services, and it's an important service to deliver. It's pretty seamlessly, I would say. This Metro Vancouver provides such a broad range of services. There's 60,000 hectares of protected watershed, 5 wastewater treatment plants. It looks after all of the regional services, the air quality, climate change, regional planning, parks, economic prosperity, and housing. And the housing function, you shouldn't take that for granted. It really is an impressive and important service provider within the Metro Vancouver region. And how do we know that we're doing well? Well, Metro Vancouver measures its performance. We spend a lot of time looking at how the services are doing. And when you speak to the regional growth strategy, 98% of residential growth has been contained within the urban containment boundary. That is a very successful model, and I would argue that I would challenge you to find a community or region that has performed better than that. So, I'm sorry, I'm looking at the wrong slide here. So is the current system broken? I would say, no, it's not broken. You do have elected representation. You have it through the councils who have elected council members and mayors who are then appointed to the board by their peers on their councils. It's cost effective. There are economies of scale achieved through the delivery of utilities, regional utilities, and the regional planning functions, whether it's economic development or regional planning or housing. The taxpayers under the regional district model, they only pay for the services they receive. So you're not paying for services that you don't receive, which may well be the case in an amalgamated or a region that's run by regionally elected directors. Metro Vancouver has a long history of success. It's dating back over 100 years. The sewer district actually was established in 1914 and the water district in 1924. And the regional district has been in place since 1967 and the housing corporation since 1974. It's a long history, a long track record of success. And I don't hear people complaining when I was at Metro Vancouver about the services that they were receiving. It was more worried about, is this a functional government? And when you're getting the services that are so important to your quality of life, that should tell you everything. It really is uniquely structured to meet the needs of this region over the next 100 years. So Metro Vancouver has a very challenging geography. You're surrounded by mountains and waterways, and it's done such a successful job of going back in the early century to create systems that better the lives of our taxpayers, regional planning, regional parks, air quality, and so on. It's not an easy region to manage those services. It's very diverse. We're very fortunate to have a Treaty First Nation, Tsawwassen First Nation, as part of our governance body. There's only a couple of treaty nations within BC, and so this model is really not broken, and in our opinion, it does not need fixing. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you, Carol.
With 16 seconds to go, I might add, that's pretty amazing.
I'll take it.
In fact, I want to next introduce Michael Haney to argue the pro side, the second half of the pro side. Michael, why don't you come? Thank you, Carol, so much.
So this isn't my slide, is this? Okay, here we go.
Okay, so my partner started off this debate explaining that for the big issues facing our region, we've been fed far more talk than action from our regional government. My intent now is to describe how we might change things so that we could have a far more effective regional government. The fundamental problem with our present governance structure is that there's little political accountability at the regional level. In terms of governance, if we start by looking at the municipal level, it's pretty straightforward. Mayors and councillors are elected by their constituents, and it's very clear who they're accountable to. Generally speaking, this works pretty well, and if residents don't get what they want, they can vote the bums out. The challenge comes when these municipal politicians are asked to serve on the Metro Board. Increasingly, they see their roles there as an opportunity to advocate for their municipality's interests rather than objectively pursue what's best for the region as a whole. This is exacerbated by the fact that two cities control almost half the voting power, effectively giving them the opportunity to form an alliance to control the regional agenda to their benefit. In addition to Metro, for regional transportation, we have another entity called TransLink, and their board and the Mayor's Council is effectively subject to the same challenges and conflicts that I described for Metro. What this all means is that the staff at Metro and TransLink are not only constantly walking on eggshells trying to develop plans that will not rile up their benefactors, they're also faced with a complex game of whack-a-mole as they try and get the necessary consensus to move forward. This inevitably means plans get watered down and compromised, and even then, once approved, they can still be undermined by their boards later. Regional issues frequently get bumped upstairs to senior governments where the big power and money is. Regional representatives and accountability is even more limited here. These senior governments often have minimal representation from Metro, and as a result, have a pretty limited understanding of the region. Now, this would be less of a problem if there was a strong regional voice that could direct senior government support to where it would be most effective. Unfortunately, that's not the case, and these senior governments are left trying to respond to a cacophony of voices from the various municipalities in the region, with the larger, more resourced cities having a huge advantage over the others. So how might a new, more accountable regional government be structured? Well, if you look around the world, there's a spectrum of different types of regional governance models. This spectrum ranges from systems with little regional authority, such as the entirely voluntary associations in some of the US cities, to highly authoritative situations where an entire urban region was amalgamated into a powerful single entity, as happened in Auckland. You can see Metro Vancouver is only slightly up from the purely voluntary model. I think there's some things we can learn from these other cities, and I'd like to quickly explore a couple of examples. The first is the partial amalgamation of Greater Toronto that occurred around 24 years ago. In this case, the Ontario government unilaterally decided to amalgamate the city of Toronto with its neighboring five cities, ostensibly for efficiencies and cost savings. It's now been proven that this amalgamation didn't save any money at all. Furthermore, as you can see from the inset map, the new city of Toronto is only a portion of the Greater Toronto Area, so the GTA continues to experience many of the challenges we're grappling with here in Metro Vancouver. One positive thing that came out of the Toronto amalgamation was the Toronto Community Housing Corporation, which operates at a scale that enjoys significant efficiencies and strategic advantages. The other example I want to share is actually quite similar to our present two-tier structure, and that's the Greater London Authority. Unlike Metro Vancouver, the Greater London government is elected by and accountable to the region. The Greater London Authority was created a year after the Toronto amalgamation, although in this case, the central government held a referendum to obtain local approval before implementing it. In this example, the 33 existing London borough councils were maintained. This has left the boroughs with a clear sense of identity and political accountability for local community services. The Greater London model is a strong mayor system. The mayor's office is responsible for developing and implementing a broad strategic plan for Greater London, as well as responsibility for things like transit, economic development, and the police, very similar to the issues we're discussing here this evening, all critically important urban systems and activities that transcend municipal borders. The mayor is joined by the 25-member London Assembly, which is made up of 11 members voted for on an at-large basis, and another 14 voted in specifically by each of the 14 constituencies that make up Greater London. The main responsibilities for the Assembly is to hold the mayor into account. They can't sack the mayor, but the mayor requires a minimum two-thirds majority support from the Assembly to approve their budget, and so this does require a reasonable level of cooperation. One of the primary responsibilities of the mayor is to prepare the London Plan. This strategic plan dictates the general spatial development and land uses for Greater London. The various boroughs must follow the mayor's plan with all their local planning and approvals, although for significant projects, the boroughs are bypassed and the projects are managed by the regional authority directly. A number of progressive initiatives have been advanced by the London Mayor. The pedestrianization of Trafalgar Square is a great example. Since the creation of the Greater London Authority, funding from the central government to support urban initiatives such as this has been much more consistent and reliable. Speaking of traffic, one of the early triumphs was the implementation of a congestion zones to reduce the use of cars traveling into the city. This had an immediate positive effect and is now being expanded. On the economic development front, leadership from the mayor's office has been highly effective in securing London's position as a global financial powerhouse. The value of having a strong regional leadership cannot be overstated. This leadership provides London with significant influence internationally and gives that most challenging issue of our time, the global phenomenon of climate change, gives them a place on the stage. In closing, we'd like to propose that we create a Metro Vancouver Authorities, in many ways an evolution of our present two-tier structure, but organized similarly to London's with an elected regional mayor and assembly. We propose that the municipalities remain intact to maintain local identities and to provide their local communities with the services that they can best administer. We're proposing that in addition to an elected mayor, there's a new 18-seat regional metro assembly to be created to hold the mayor accountable. The assembly would be drawn from 9 constituencies representing about 300,000 each, and another 9 members would be elected at large. Of the 9 elected at large, we're proposing that 7 would be elected by the full region, and to ensure that there are Indigenous voices on the table, the remaining 2 would be elected from the First Nations population living in Metro. This new model would see Metro Vancouver and TransLink combined with elected and accountable leadership.
Well done. Thank you, Michael. Greg Moore, come to the floor and argue the con side.
Thank you. Thank you. That was a great opening up. Though I'm more confused than when I started with all of this, elected this, not elected this, 300,000, oh my goodness, we have a system that works already. So would electing a local government be more effective and more accountable? Really, that's what this boils down to. And I just want to ask a quick question in the audience. How many people have been to a Metro Vancouver meeting in the last, 3 years? Exactly. 3 people. So really, these people didn't even put up their hands. And they're arguing that it's not effective? That is kind of fascinating, isn't it? So Michael talked about Toronto. So let's look at Toronto. 20 years later, higher taxes, less coordination, reduced opportunity, less engagement. Could you imagine what it would be like to get a meeting with the mayor of Toronto? Really, could you? I know when I was the mayor of Poco, anybody could walk through my door and they would get a meeting probably the same day. That's accountable. They could talk about local issues. They could talk about my position at Metro Vancouver, my position at TransLink. That's accessible. If you think you, has anybody here tried to get a meeting with the mayor of Vancouver by phoning up the switchboard and asking for a meeting? It just doesn't happen. So if you want to talk about regional representation and the strong mayor thing, let's take a look at some examples. You might not get the best mayor in the world. You might get a mayor that represents the suburbs. Right? I'm sure this is a very Vancouver crowd. Did you know that Surrey, Maple Ridge, and Langley have more population than Vancouver? Do you think that they're going to really care when they get elected about the Broadway plan and the fact that they're capping the heights at 39 stories, while Coquitlam and Burnaby and other places are taking 40, 80, 50-story buildings? You'd be like, no, we need to pile more density. We spent $3 billion on a transit line. We're going to put as much density around there as possible because you know what? I get elected in the suburbs. We don't have to look far. That happened in Toronto. If you talk about London, as Michael brought up, so sure, there's one person. Heaven forbid we had one politician making all of the decisions. But there's one person. So development is moves at a glacier pace here. Right? It goes through municipal government. In London, it does the same thing, but if it's big enough, it's a regional significant, then it's got to go to another layer of elected officials. That is just going to slow things down even more and more. I'm not even sure where to start with the TransLink. I might actually agree that there should be some elected people on the TransLink board, because right now they're not even locally elected people. They're appointed by individuals. So I think there is some room for growth in the TransLink model, as I think we argued quite a bit when we were actually elected in the region, representing the regional voice. So really, I think part of this just boils down, do we actually want more politicians? Look at it, we have 146 locally elected people already. My colleagues here want to have more. When is the last time someone said, hey, let's have more politicians, it'll be more efficient, it'll be more effective, we'll get things done faster. Yeah, I know, let's have more of them. I think we should be arguing the opposite. We should maybe reduce, maybe we should talk about amalgamating the Langleys, amalgamating the Tri-Cities, amalgamating White Rock with Surrey. Maybe that's a better conversation to have, not actually have more politicians as we go through things. So we already have more, or we want more politicians, we have that. Would the more bureaucracy also help with the situation? It adds another layer of complexity if we were to have another layer of government. It just doesn't make sense to us, and it adds more cost to everything we do. So right now, if we had more elected folks, or if we directly elected, we would have a disconnected environment. Right now, as the mayor of Port Coquitlam, sitting on the TransLink, sitting on Metro Vancouver, yes, I represented my own community's voice, but I also put that hat and I represented the region. And I thought as a region. I came together to ensure that I understood that growth in Vancouver and growth in Surrey and sewer, water, transit was important for the whole region to grow. But if I wasn't elected locally and regionally, we would fight. What if the locally, the regional, the 300,000 person that they said in the Tri-Cities, I'll assume that was one of them, I can't remember your map, didn't represent a community in Port Coquitlam or didn't represent some of the, now you're gonna have the mayor of Port Coquitlam fighting with the regional representative who's fighting with the provincial and who's fighting with the federal. Right now, at least the local government and the regional government are the same people and they represent the same taxpayers and they have the same voice when they're working with, not fighting with, the senior levels of government. You wouldn't have a voice. Municipalities would be then bickering, like I said, with the regional government. There would be conflicts all over the place and things would just slow right down. But don't take it our word for it. Look around different articles from Western Ontario or University of Western Ontario, SFU, and others that have talked about how great the Metro Vancouver model is, that you do have locally represented people sitting at the regional table with that voice. They are accountable. If you don't think they're accountable, if you don't think they're gonna lose an election because what they do at Metro Vancouver, ask George Puel. Ask the mayor of Richmond, not Malcolm Brody, the previous one. They all basically lost their local jobs because of the work and the positions they took at the regional district. So people are paying attention. Or, as this audience, needs to maybe pay more attention to what actually the local elected people are doing to ensure that you understand. And there's lots of regional regional leadership that's going on beyond what's mandated by the local government. So here's just a few examples. Talk about addressing homelessness with the provincial government. Let's not forget, and Chris's argument was great about housing, but housing technically is not, or affordable housing is not technically a local government responsibility. It's a federal and provincial government responsibility that local governments, in cooperation regionally, have decided to take on that issue to tackle it because there wasn't enough being done. Metro Vancouver Housing Corporation, with your locally elected folks, is the largest housing provider in British Columbia. Right? So it over 10,000 people are elected or are housed because of Metro Vancouver. I got 19 seconds. Lastly, again, don't take it for us. This is just a piece of the awards that Metro Vancouver has received all the way from the United Nations to locally about the effectiveness of the delivery system at Metro Vancouver.
Tunneling Association.
Thank you.
So now we're going to relax a little bit, but not very much. We're going to give you an opportunity to talk to one another, to argue some of the cases that you've individually made. I think we've seen good cases, pro and con. Wouldn't you say that? We've seen good cases, pro and con. So now let's try to really hone in on
what are the contradictions in those two ideas? So I'm just going to open the floor. And then as soon as there are questions, raise your hand so that I can see you. And we'll ask you to ask the question. And if there are questions coming from online, I think someone's going to give me those questions. So we have about 20 minutes for this. And let's open the floor. Since we just heard one side, would you like to make a comment to start us off?
Sure.
Christina or Michael?
Let's start with some one of Greg's last points about the important housing function. And I agree, Metro Vancouver Housing Corporation is a great corporation and sensitive to localities, great for family housing. But it's a real shame that they have so few units. On a per capita basis, the Capital Regional District has three times the number of units on a per capita basis. So that's an example of me, of the region being starved of funds, that they're a good provider, got a housing crisis, they should be given the money to do a lot more.
So can I just ask you, the Capital Regional District you said has more housing?
No, per capita.
Per capita.
Yeah.
Is the Capital Regional District Board of Directors elected directly?
I'm just saying as an example.
No, no, but are they elected directly?
No,
because that's
not
the debate
but
topic.
But I'm saying, you're saying the great performance, but here a little municipality or CRD of 400,000 has three times the amount of public housing per capita as.
Great response.
Sure. My point is they're not elected directly. They are a federation just like Metro Vancouver.
Yeah.
Maybe their federation has been more effective. Fair enough. But it's not because they were directly elected that they have more housing per capita.
No, what I'm trying to make the point is that you could be doing way more with the Metro Vancouver Housing Corporation.
I think a great example is the Toronto example. The Toronto amalgamation, I don't think, is particularly successful in many ways, but the housing is a bright light. I mean, they've really taken advantage of economies of scale, and it was so successful within a few years, the province shifted all of their housing over so it could be administered at the regional level, or at the larger city level. They now, this is the second largest public housing organization on the continent. They house 165,000 people, and they have $1 billion annual budget, and they can use that strategically to revitalize parts of the city. The stuff they're doing in Regent's Park, for instance, they never could have done before. And that's what's really exciting about the scale of the region.
Carol, I can see you want to answer.
And I think that's the point. We're not saying that it's a perfect model and always trying to improve on the system, but the housing affordability within Metro Vancouver is broken. The CRD, there's no coincidence that that's the seat of the provincial government, but the problem is that you've got the federal government, you've got the provincial government. You comment that the province gave the responsibility back to Metropolitan Toronto. Again, another example of you've got this real dichotomy between what are the provincial responsibilities and the municipal responsibilities, and how are you going to fund this? Because I can tell you that funding new housing development within Metro Vancouver is extraordinarily expensive, just prohibitive, and it is going to rely on partnerships, which is what the new model is. I think you spoke to it, Christine, is the new model going forward to create more housing affordability. And the cornerstone to that is working with the member municipalities in partnership with Metro Vancouver's Housing Corporation to do that. So, yeah.
Great. Do we have any questions or comments from the audience so far? Yes, sir. Stand up and speak loudly.
Yeah, thank you for organizing this. My question is more about the check and balances on the current model. If you could speak towards that, what are the current checks and balances that exist for the accountability in the region?
And I think you would want to pose that to either Carol or Greg, is that right? Which one? Okay, Greg or Carol.
So the checks and balances, I think, happen throughout the year. So having, as I mentioned in my opening statement, it was Mayor Halsey Brandt out of Richmond. He was unelected in an election because of the decisions he was making at Metro Vancouver. Councillor George Puhle, who was the chair of Metro Vancouver and TransLink at the time, also was unelected because of the decisions he was making there. So part of democracy isn't just the politicians encouraging and trying to get people to participate, it's also residents participating. If we want more accountability regionally, locally, provincially, federally, Frankly, it's up to us as society to hold people accountable. I sat at Metro Vancouver for 10 years. I can probably count on two hands how many times the media actually came to a Metro Vancouver meeting. So I think there's a lot that can happen. It doesn't mean the system's broken, but it means that I think society also has to do more to hold Metro Vancouver or local governments accountable. You know, Port Coquitlam, we had one media that showed up every once in a while, and it was usually only when something negative happened. So there wasn't, frankly, a ton of accountability that was happening there either. Now, social media, I'll suggest, is changing that, maybe not for the positive, but definitely making more transparency of what's happening regardless of how people are elected at the regional district.
Okay, any other questions or that? I'm going to pose one to the pro side, and then I have one for the con side. The one to the pro side is, if we do have these two levels of elected governments, local and regional, how do we handle the contradictory voting decisions that might come out from those two levels? How do you feel that should be handled? In other words, a decision from all the local governments to do one thing, a decision by the regional government to do the opposite thing.
Well, that's why how it's set up is so critical, Larry, because, and that's the strength of the London model, is because there's a clear hierarchy, and the mayor's office is responsible for creating the London plan, which the others have to follow.
Right.
They have no choice, they have to follow. And the mayor also has a position that if there's a project that is strategically important, it doesn't even have to be a big one, they can pull it out and deal with it directly. That leaves the local governments to do what they really do best, which is to look after their communities, to deal with their community services. They can deal with the parking, they can deal with the libraries, all the things that matter to the communities, and then they're relieved of having to deal with the big things, which frankly they can't do.
But a rejoinder is that I notice local governments like to deal with the big issues of the day, as well as parking and things like that.
But the reality is they can't do it. And so that's why we need to have another level that can do it. And the other problem is the senior governments can't do it either because they don't understand it. So and they're getting feedback from these 21 different municipalities all telling them something different. And they don't have enough knowledge themselves to do the right thing. So you get these terrible kind of knee-jerk reactions from the provincial government.
Would you like to comment on this?
I'll just jump in and say that's the beauty of the regional district model. The smaller municipalities, whether it's Anmore or Belcarra, Bowen Island, they couldn't deliver services without being part of that larger unit. And the regional district does that, and does that successfully, not just in Metro Vancouver, but Capital Regional District, Nanaimo Regional District, Peace River, across the province. It helps the small jurisdictions by having the larger jurisdictions then piggyback onto that. They wouldn't be able to provide those services on their own. And I go back to you to say, so that system is not broken.
So the strong mayor system, if we just use today's politicians as an example, Mayor McCallum in Surrey would be the mayor of this region. I'm not sure that's a good plan, Michael. I'm not sure if I want a suburban mayor determining what's going to happen on the Broadway corridor. And I'm not sure if I want the mayor of Vancouver or the mayor of Vancouver / Richmond and a little bit of Burnaby determining what happens in Maple Ridge in an agricultural urban area or a non-urban area. They might say, I'm taking too much growth in Vancouver. We're going to push out into the agricultural area because I don't really care. I don't get any votes out there anyways. But now with having regional representation, and I will correct you, sorry, but Surrey and Vancouver only represent 42% of the vote, so they do need to have regional cooperation. They do not have a veto vote at TransLink or at Metro Vancouver. They have to get others
but
to come along
very
and cooperate.
That they have to get.
So
if you look at the votes around the region, it's rare that Vancouver and Surrey share exactly where they want to go, so they have to give and take, which makes that federation work.
Short rejoinder if you want.
No, that's fine.
Okay, all right. Now I'm going to pose a question over to the con side, Greg and Carol. In the current system, there are, and you referenced it, so few citizens who are involved and who feel connected and accountable to these regional matters and regional decisions. And that seems to be a disconnect in a democracy between elected officials making decisions and those decisions and how the electors feel about that. Is that endemic to the current system, or are there ways to improve that?
I'll just jump in. Well, I think as a result of COVID, the movement towards electronic meetings actually does assist in the engagement for the public and to the electorate to be able to see board meetings. So that has been a game changer for us. But regional districts, they're accountable through the appointment of the municipal council directors to the board. They are voting on the budgets that their taxpayers are going to pay. So you don't get a regional tax bill in your mailbox. It's being funneled through your municipal tax bill, and it's outlined specifically what it is you're paying for. So it's very accountable in that way.
So I'll go to this side. Is that, do you feel that there could be, should be, in this existing system, another way to reach out more and connect to citizens? Is it possible or is it impossible?
Absolutely. Carol's talking a lot about services but that are pretty simple to cooperate on, and I agree, and it's a good system. I'm talking about the critical issues in this debate, housing, climate change, regional planning issues, where we aren't getting that level of cooperation. And to give you an example, there was a public hearing the other day for the new Metro Vancouver 2050. 10 people showed up only, and 2 written submissions. Now that's not an engaged public on a plan that only gets renewed every 10 years.
But maybe that's a sign of it wasn't broken. It's a great plan, and it really builds on Metro 2040. So
it's actually. And it has weaker been, than 2040.
So says the author.
And it has been fully vetted by the member jurisdictions. So there have been a lot of eyes, including TransLink and other jurisdictions, that have looked at the plan.
I see 2 hands. I'm going to go back to the back first and come forward next. So stand up and speak out.
Yeah, hello. Oh, this is more of a clarification question for the pro side. What would the actual responsibilities of the regional government be in the proposed plan? Because I feel like there's a little bit of conflict about, like, you know, whether it's like services or what's happening in the Broadway corridor being determined by the thing as a whole. So if you could clarify that a little bit more.
We'll probably tag team on this, but it tends to be focusing on the things that are cross-boardal. So it would be building on the incredible strengths that we have as Metro as a utility. Metro is a brilliant utility, and they're providing all of these utility services very well. We want to expand that. And fundamental to that, to solve the big issues that we're trying to face now, is having a strong plan that can be enforced. And so this idea of establishing the regional plan, and then that becomes the guidelines for everyone else that can truly deal with climate change and housing and all of these big challenges we have that cross borders.
Yeah, so the principle is what level of government do you need to solve the problem? So that industrial land's a great example. So every Monday night, councils were voting on their own, okay, let's change this industrial land to housing or retail or office. So you wake up and all of a sudden there's not an industrial land base for the region. So those things that do need that regional level of jurisdiction would go to the directly elected regional government, who are much more accountable. And Greg hasn't talked about it much, but you know, many of those board meetings, I didn't see any regional hats in the room, but a lot of local hats making decisions.
All right, want to do a rejoinder? If not, I'm going to move on to the next question. I don't see an urgency to do that, so if
no,
you
don't
want...
No, I don't think I needed a response.
The gentleman, the person who's just right there. Sir, stand up.
Thank you. Just a quick from my point. I'm on the Seniors Advisory Committee at City of Vancouver, and just wondering in terms of competitive competition between the municipalities. It seems like it's really holding back, and I think what I've been noticing that lately there's been a lot of kind of one trying to go through the other. That's one comment. The other one, how do we kind of create that harmony between that region? I guess I'm speaking on the pro side, but at the same time, the second part of the question is that I understand housing is the kind of the glue that puts it together, but what about the other infrastructure in terms of hospitals, you know, how do we manage that in terms of environment and getting the regional, the region to control those environmental issues?
And you're putting that to the pro side, to the con side. Okay.
Well, I think one of the things that our colleagues are arguing to a certain extent, and you did by saying the word hospital, is as someone that's a local remember, our local governments are paid by property tax. That's the and utility fees. I don't want my property taxes to pay for more affordable housing. They do in a regional model. I don't want my property taxes to pay for hospitals. That's what I pay income tax and corporate tax and sales tax. And dynamic taxes are meant to pay for those regional services, those provincial-wide services. So they don't even have the right funding authority, the right tools to do it. So I wouldn't be arguing, one, for more politicians or for more authority unless the taxing authority came with it, because what's going to happen is your property taxes are going to crank up for it. And I can tell you, being on the front lines for 15 years trying to debate with two different provincial governments about opening up and allow local governments, whether it was regional or local, to have some different type of taxing authority, the always was answer was no, because it takes away from their revenue. And so I think if we look at good regional work that has happened, take a look at TransLink. Might disagree with the governance model, but regardless of that, we have the 10-year plan that's being implemented right now with the Broadway line. A line in Vancouver was approved by all but one mayor in this region. That's regional cooperation. They weren't directly elected. I had to go home to Port Coquitlam and talk to people in the grocery store to tell them why I voted in favor of a $3 billion SkyTrain line in Vancouver. Why? 4% of the people that were going to use that line were when it's built are from Port Coquitlam. So it actually benefited Port Coquitlam, even though it wasn't geographically there. That's just a demonstration of when you have good regional, locally elected people representing the region and taking their hat off, that they can do those things and make those decisions, and to the person behind you, still have to be accountable when they go home.
Now I see two questions. There's a gentleman there, and then next up front of that. So go ahead.
So questions to Christina, two very quick questions. In 2011, the Metro 2040 plan was passed, and I remember watching that plan and looking at the climate change chapter and seeing it go through three iterations and getting watered down and watered down further. It took several years to get that approved. How many years did it take to get that plan approved?
How many years did it take to get approved? Yeah, and the reason why, you know, we could have really watered it down and got it through quickly, but what we wanted to do with that plan is actually put regulation in it. So the plan before that didn't even have a line, a statutory line to tell you where the urban containment boundary was. So we did, you know, all the work to do to pin down the urban containment boundary, pin down the industrial land designation. So what there was a lot of controversial elements in that plan, which took a lot of back and forth with the municipalities to understand the pros and cons, and how does the region as a whole benefit by each municipality giving up a bit of local autonomy.
Maybe let's turn that over to the other side to respond.
Well, I don't have a crystal ball, but it will go through the process. All of the jurisdictions have to approve it at their respective councils, and then it will come back for third reading. So it's a bylaw process, and then it does get referred out to TransLink and the adjacent regional districts. I suspect there's going to be a lot of work happening right now between Metro Vancouver staff and Surrey staff, working through those issues that are outstanding to see if they can reach a solution, because you're quite right that Metro 2050 will not be able to be adopted unless there is unanimous consent from the respective councils around the table and Tsawwassen First Nation electoral area A directors. So time will tell, but again, that's the federation model, and you may have the same thing happen under the model that's being proposed by the pro side, but there would be more conflict because there would be less of that direct connection between our member municipalities and the regional entity. And that's what works with this model, is that there's that direct connection between
the municipal staff and councils and the regional staff and councils to make that function.
So we're coming toward the end of our time, but the last voice is going to go to a TransLink voice, and I think that's appropriate. So go ahead.
Thank you. One of the things that Metro Vancouver as a region is often praised for is the stability and continuity of plans over the years. And in fact, if you look at Metro 2040 or Metro 2050, you can see the roots back all the way back to, say, 1975, the Livable Region Plan, that there's been many, many elements that have been very, very stable. And the federation approach means that in any given municipal election cycle, there's stability. There's largely, there's a lot of stability. There's very rarely wholesale turnover of every at every council. And that affords stability over the years of people who've been around and continuity. So my question is for the pro side, does your proposal, and recognizing there's no perfect governance solution, right? There's no perfect model, it's always a matter of trade-offs. So does your proposal trade off the benefits of a regional perspective and people bringing more of a regional perspective with the risks of loss of stability and the more large scale swings from one side to the other as we've seen in other regions?
Great question. To your side.
Start? Okay, thanks, Sarah, for that question. I think it'll bring more stability. I think under the current system, we can see big problems with the metropolitan land use structure. The regional city centers, for example, are not doing nearly well enough. In this day and age, with the climate change imperative, we should not be touching that urban containment boundary. Every time we touch it, you have to send buses out there, there has to be services and so on, so we absolutely have to draw a hard line. So if you're saying stability is, leading to a less efficient region plan, then I would trade that off and say, okay, what are we going to get under a system where you have directly elected regional government, I think it'd be a strong and accountable system. And things like housing, I don't want to pour in the hundreds of millions of dollars at the regional level, which I think is the right level for public housing, without directly elected regional government. So with the funds coming in from the senior governments, then there has to be accountability in the spending of that money.
And a short last word.
Well, I guess, I'm not sure it's broken. We put up a slide that 98% of growth is happening within the urban containment boundary. The city centers are working. It's a competitive marketplace in the private sector. The private sector is more determining where they want to invest their money than maybe the local governments. I know local mayors around the region would love to have more office buildings, would love to have more diversity in land use in their city centers. But for some reason, the development community gravitates to Vancouver all of the time. And so unless you're going to get a regional mayor that's going to say no growth in Vancouver, we're going to put it all in the suburbs, that might solve the issue that you're highlighting, but I'm not sure if it really creates a more livable region in cooperation.
And to the stability question that was raised, what would be your...
Well, this last time around, we had the biggest turnover of mayors in recent history. I think, 13 out of the 20 mayors turned over, or something like that. Yet, we still have the stability. Talk about efficiency too. They started Metro 2050 during this last election period after this new vote mayors got in. They started the TransLink 2050 after this, and they've got it to the finish line. Now it has to go out and get regional support. The Broadway plan started 4.5 years ago, and who knows if that's gonna get passed, right? And that is with a locally elected, directly elected group. So there is more efficiency, and we did see the rollover and stability when we saw actually a large turnover elected people in the region.
Okay, well, we've heard comments, questions. I want to thank our panel for your reactions and taking these questions very seriously. And I also want to thank the audience, the members who in the audience who posed those questions. I think they have helped us to get the issue more clearly in our minds about which is the best system moving forward. So now we're going to move to that final round, the round where you make your closing arguments. Again, just to remind everyone, Each of the debaters will have 2 minutes to sum up. Again, I'm going to be kind of aggressive on those two-minute time frames. It is an opportunity to rebut what you've heard from the other side. So with that, we'll do the same order. Christina, you're up.
Okay, thanks. So I want to tell you that I am a fan of the municipal level of government and the sense of community, placemaking, local knowledge, and history it offers. So in order to reinforce municipal government, a strong regional system is needed to solve the problems that cannot be solved at the individual municipal level. From 2006 to 2016, the three metropolitan areas of Toronto, Montreal, and Vancouver captured 50% of the national population growth and 2/3 of the job growth. So clearly the metropolitan scale needs careful thinking, rethinking as the geography for focused action. A new regional governance system, as Michael outlined, is essential to amplifying the metropolitan voice. The region is going to have to manage up and help figure out how best to collaborate with the province and federal governments to maximize the strengths of each level of government in solving metropolitan problems. I didn't get a chance to talk about transportation much. There are several governance issues that needs tackling. Transport 2050 is full of great ideas and projects. It also contains a list of financial and governance issues at the back. Chapter 7, for example, is how will we fund, which indeed ends up being a question and lists some of the new ways that they will try to find stable, adequate funding, which is essential and not there right now. Chapter 8 is titled, how will we organize ourselves, and lists many pressing governance issues and even recommends a task group to deal with these governance issues. TransLink's financing and governance issues are de facto Metro Vancouver's issues too, and they need to be solved together. And I just, in closing, I will end my remarks with a quote to honor Regional Director Harold Steeves. Everyone will know him as a longtime regionalist, farmer, Richmond councillor, and MLA. He is retiring this year after 50 years of political service. The other day at the Metro Board, he had to remind his fellow directors, as he has done many, many times over the years, it's about time we acted like a regional government, not a collection of feuding cities demanding our own way.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Carol, over to you for your two.
Thank you, Larry. So as I said in my opening statement, if it's not broken, don't fix it. Yes, it's true that no governance structure is perfect, and Metro Vancouver is not perfect, but it is misunderstood. And we've heard that tonight because all of the focus has been on the growth strategy and how successful is that being. And I can tell you, it has been very successful. But Metro Vancouver is so much more than that. And it's not just about the utilities, about water and sewer and solid waste. It is about the climate plan, Climate 2050, the work that they've done with TransLink on the TransLink plan. The parks plan, the economic prosperity, and all of the other services they provide. But the resolution that we're debating tonight is saying that this is a time that requires decisive regional action. Well, that has happened. It is there, and it has been a success story. We've seen other places around the country and around the world, quite frankly, where the wrong leadership taking decisive regional action results in poor governance and sometimes much worse than that. So in Metro Vancouver, there are systems in place. I think we heard the TransLink question about the stability of Metro, which basically was my closing statements here, is that Metro Vancouver is very stable. It's structured in a way to ensure good government. The board chair and vice chair are elected annually by their peers. So if you don't have a good chair, they're up for election on an annual basis. Directors are appointed annually from their municipal councils. There's a strong committee structure that not only has board directors, but it also includes council members from the member municipalities so that they understand the issues and are knowledgeable about voting on it. The Metro Vancouver CAO commissioner is a non-voting member of the board, and that of the water and sewer boards, and that ensures the continuity despite changes in the electoral process. The administration is accountable, and it's selected by a federation of elected officials. It's less prone to upheaval with changes in municipal council and mayor, and it's what our population needs right now in regional government: stability, fiscal prudence,
and vision through a shared leadership. I think I took my extra seconds from
you.
My,
did.
Yeah. I think I'm good with that.
Thank you, Carol. Michael, your two.
Well, I think in summary, an elected regional government such as the Metro Vancouver Authority we proposed really would provide that political accountability to the region, and it would provide a clear sort of voice for senior government that doesn't understand our region to talk to. I mean, there's a great example. The recent expert panel on housing supply and affordability in BC came out with this, which was commissioned by the federal government and the province. It came out with this big report. They didn't even find Metro Vancouver relevant enough to even mention. I mean, it's just it practically doesn't exist in their minds. And this would give it that clarity. It would provide the leadership and to be able to implement a regional plan. The city center's plans really aren't working. I mean, we've got towers there, but they're really just bedroom suburbs for the metro core, where the SkyTrains are still mostly empty, running in the other direction. It's not doing what the original plan was meant to do. I think it would provide a platform to take on all other kinds of challenges and responsibilities, like economic development and a regional police force and all the other things that we're struggling with as a region. I want to finish, though, by talking a little bit about the Greater London Authority, which I enjoyed learning about. And that concept was developed during a debate, much like this one. It was sponsored by the Architecture Foundation. It was put together by a group, including the architect Richard Rogers, who realized that if London was to live up to its potential, it needed a new, more effective governance structure. In the audience that night was Tony Blair, then leader of the opposition. As a result of that debate, governance reform for Greater London became part of his party's platform, and the rest is history. So I urge you to maintain and to vote in support of this resolution so that together we too can help Metro Vancouver better live up to its potential and become a more equitable, effective, and sustainable city.
Thank you, Mark.
Greg, you have the last 2 minutes.
Thank you. Thanks, Larry. Thanks to Urbanarium for putting this on. Thanks for all of you about getting engaged about this topic. Obviously, we get excited about it. I wasn't sure anybody else really would, because as Carol pointed out, if it's not broken, why fix it? And that's somewhat our argument, and hopefully we were able to convince you about that. Our opponent's theme was more talk than action. I'm not sure putting more politicians in the mix is going to create more action. I think it will create more talk. More talk, more talk, more bureaucracy, more rules, more policy, and less efficiency. I don't know. When I think of efficiency, I don't think of the City of Toronto. In fact, I don't think of the City of London. When we went to the City of London and we met with the Economic Development Commission and the Transit Commission, the toll helped for a heartbeat, and then traffic went bad again, because people just assumed it. It was a cost of doing business. So I'm not sure if the outcomes in London are what we're looking to achieve. We have a federation that is forced to work together. The other argument we heard tonight was about regional governments could take on more responsibility. Sure, let's give them regional policing and housing and hospitals. Let's give them schools and other things. Well, why do we have a provincial government then that's directly elected? Shouldn't we be holding them more responsible for housing and policing and hospitals? That actually is their job. Why should we create another level of government and download or shift responsibility, thinking that they might be closer to the people? Their argument was that one person for every 300,000 people. Well, your MLAs are one for about every 60,000 people. They're more directly connected to you than the regional government that they're proposing. So why not meet with your MLA to talk about hospitals or policing or housing? That's the level of government that needs to deliver those services in cooperation with the region and the local government. The federation is strong and has brought together Climate 2050, Metro 2050, Transit 2050, and they're forced to do that through a federation of cooperation. Thank you.
Let's give them all a hand. Well done, all four, both sides. So now you can pause, you can relax a bit. It's time to vote again, to see who wins this debate. So I think we've got it online. Here is a slightly different URL for you to use, sala.ubc.ca/vote2. So we're voting again, whether you support the pro or the con, and we'll see whose minds have been changed. Let's vote now. And as the result is coming to me, just to keep the excitement going, I do want to tell you that the winning team receives what's called the Smart City Trophy, which was designed by Richard Enriquez and Ian Gress of Rethink. The other team, which is also a winning team in my book, will receive the Urbanarium t-shirt, one of the most coveted t-shirts in our city. So the first vote, pro, 77%, con, 23%. The second vote, pro, 34%. Con, 66%. A 43% increase on the con side. The con side is the winners tonight. And here come your trophy awards. Greg Moore, Carol Mason, congratulations. And the hard-argued other side, here is your awards. Bring them on.
Thank you very much.
So, thank you both. Thank you so much. It has been a fascinating conversation. So I want to thank Christina, Michael, Greg, Carol for an outstanding contribution tonight. You did a phenomenal job, in my opinion. It's getting close to time to say goodnight. As you know, the Urbanarium's purpose for this ongoing series of debates is to air really the multiple perspectives on the important issues that are facing our community in engaging and fun ways, not when we argue and hate and are not together, but when we can laugh and be together and be positive and learn and change. And so I really think this is an excellent series. And it's doing something very important for our community.